Well, good morning. Glad you're here, and what a beautiful day. And thank you very much for playing for us this morning, leading us into worship. Any special announcements that we need to mention to everybody that we don't have in the bulletin already? There's a wooden box just outside the door as you entrance the come into the entrance, and that's where we're putting there for you if you'd like to put tithes and offerings or gifts in there. So somebody asked, where do they put them? Well, just as you go outside the door, there's a box. Could you turn the headset down just a little bit? Great. Well, I want to pray before we come before the Lord to worship and to have our hearts ready. So if you'll join me in prayer, we'll go to the Lord together.
Thank you, Father, for this morning. We have so many things to be grateful for.
If we were to sit and start counting,
we would just never run out of things, and we'd run out of numbers first, Lord. So
just help us to be thankful all the time as we come before you this morning, as we look at praying and asking you for
those needs in our lives. Help us to be attentive to your Holy Spirit, because you promised that he would come and be our comforter and be with us, be the same as you in our lives. So now, prepare our hearts for worship as we sing, as we have melody in our heart, and as we listen to your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Kimberly.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
So this week, as I was thinking about Sunday, I don't know about you guys, but it seemed like almost every day something went wrong. And some of the days, the whole day went wrong. But in the midst of it all, I kept thinking about Jesus and how great he is, even in the midst of all of our troubles that we go through. And so we have four songs this morning, and they all tie in together. We're going to sing How Great Is Our God, Great Is Thy Faithfulness, Holy, 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 and then the Revelation song, which is Worthy Is the Lamb. And so if you guys want to think while we're singing about a way that God is showing himself great in your life, if you'd like to share that, I would be more than happy to have someone share between songs. We're also going to have some scriptures as well. So I'd like to ask you to stand with me for the first song, How Great Is Our God. We're not going to do like straight into the next and the next and the next like we've done for a couple Sundays. We're going to pause between and have some scriptures and reflections. So, how great is our God? Whoa.
He raps himself.
So before we sing "Great is Thy Faithfulness," does anyone have a praise for the Lord of how he's showing himself great in your life?
I've got one.
Okay.
We had a great 2 weeks with our kids.
That is good.
Yeah.
It was fun to have the kids come out to our house the other day and see all the babies.
Yeah.
That was a highlight.
Okay, so before we sing "Great is Thy Faithfulness," I have asked Cheryl if she would read a scripture for us.
This is from Lamentations 3:21-25. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to the one who seeks him.
Amen. Okay, number 43 in your hymnal. And you can stand if you want or sit if you want. We'll probably sit on this one. Have a praise they want to give?
I have the advantage of the microphone that comes on. Anyway, I've been thinking this week about I have a sister in Washington and a sister in Nevada that have health issues. We have a son in Maryland and son in Colorado, and missionaries around the world that we've been praying for. And it has just been amazing to think about. We can sit here in our little town of Chihuahua.
Amen. Anybody else?
Well, that song is something I've been pondering. Great is his faithfulness. He doesn't just save us once and then forget us. He's always there, and even when I wanted to give up and cash it in, I'm still here, so he's always faithful.
Amen. Okay, so before we sing number 262, which is Holy, 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 when I thought about the word holy, I was like, do I really know what that word means? I mean, I've heard it all of my life. And so I looked it up just to see, just to remind myself what holy means. And it means exalted or worthy of complete devotion as one perfect in goodness and righteousness. And so Jake is going to read our next scripture.
Revelation 4, 8 through 11. It says, each of the four living creatures had six wings and was covered with eyes all around, even under its wings. Day and night they never stopped saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Whenever the living creatures give glory, honor, and thanks to him who sits on the throne and who lives forever and ever. The 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They lay their crowns before the throne and say, you are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being.
Okay. So I'm going to ask you to stand on this one because I feel like you just can't sing Holy, Holy without standing. So number 262.
Oh,
before we sing the last one, does anybody else have a praise? Jerry.
I am so thankful that this spring God has given us the lilacs and I can smell them.
They're beautiful. Anyone else? Okay. John, I've asked to read the third scripture before we sing the Revelation song.
Revelation 5:11-14. Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands, and 10,000 times 10,000. And they encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they were saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise." And then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever." The four living creatures said, "Amen," and the elders fell down.
Thank you.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
home to have kids in the house and to have 14, 12, 10, and 8 all for two and a half weeks was an incredible blessing. It was a blessing. But so is getting married. So is having a baby. So is buying a house. But those things are all stressors, aren't they? They are really great when you have your cabin. Isn't that a great thing? And it's easy, right? I've been at Brian's house. I've seen him put the chains on and pull a calf, so I know how. It's a great thing, but it comes with good stressors. So what I'm going to give you is my devotion I gave for the kids this week. And it's a parable. And it's a parable that I'm going to read to you, and it's about God's good graces. But before I share with you about God's good graces in his parable in Matthew chapter 20, I'll share with you an experience that I had. And it was one of those experiences that you just need to see more of. And if you've ever been around somebody who has a deathbed conversion, it is a life-changing event for the person who is praying to accept the Lordship of Christ into their lives. And it's a life-changing event for you, because someone who you may have been praying for, or you were praying for, to have the eyes of their heart open up to see their need for Christ, all of a sudden, towards the last minutes and seconds of their life, they recognize their need for the Savior and their need for repentance. And the text I would turn to would be 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10. And I will read that to you right now. For godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death. And I think that the person we could turn to in the Bible would be the thief on the cross, who, though he had no way to demonstrate and manifest a changed life, the Lord Jesus, the King of all creation, the God of the universe, who breathed stars into being, he looked at that man and said, "You will be with me today in paradise." And I had the experience of having a father-in-law. He was the man that was my mother-in-law's second husband since then and I got married. The first father-in-law, he died early in life, about 56 or 57. And then when mom remarried, that gentleman, Shorty, was very belligerent. He was a Democrat who came into money, so he had Republican persuasions. And he always told me, "Mike, you know what a Republican is, right?" "Well, no, Shorty, what?" He goes, "Well, it's a Democrat who got money." And so he lived to talk politics, but he did not receive Christ until hours or maybe a day before he died. And I can remember going into his hospital room and sharing the gospel with him one more time. And him praying and saying, "I want to receive Christ into my heart as my Lord and Savior and trust in him." And praying with him. And I think all of us need more of those experiences where he prayed and he received Christ as his Lord and Savior. And he asked God to forgive him of his sins. And the difference between prior to that and after that was night and day. It really reflects this text, where there was a godly sorrow that led to repentance, that brought salvation in his life, which does, if you're a true believer, there's going to be a difference. There's going to be that salvation experience where your life changes, and it did for him. I can remember him communicating with us, saying, "All those things that I believed about abortion, I was just thinking this, but I see now that it was wrong." And it wasn't that I persuaded him. It was the Spirit of God coming into his heart and changing his heart. And he went through time after that expressing sorrow for a change of life. That's a great experience. But would there be any of us who would say, "Well, that's not fair. I had to go through a whole life of dealing with the persecution of being a Christian. I had to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune. I had to suffer through people who I work with and who I live with who didn't like my convictions and the things that I believe about the Bible. It's just not fair that Shorty gets to go into heaven." We wouldn't do that, would we? Well, let's go to a parable where Jesus in Matthew chapter 20 actually talks about the good graces of our loving God. Matthew chapter 20, I'll race you. How many of you did Bible drills when you were young? Matthew chapter 20, It's a great text. I like this text, but you have to include verse 30 before you read it, because he concludes his parable with the same verse prior to the not-so-inspired big 2-0 in Matthew 20. Don't forget, those aren't necessarily inspired. Those are good breaks in the text. Verse 30, but many who are first will be last, and the last first. For, great conjunction there, big word, conjunction, rebinding what he just said, what he's going to say. For the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers, Matthew 20?
What verse are you on?
I'm on Matthew 20, verse 1.
Thank you.
Okay.
We're on 1930.
Yeah, I was on 1930, the prior verse, so now I'm leading into it. So I'll do that again. But many who are first will be last, and the last first. Then verse chapter 20. For the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for a denarius a day, he sent them into his vineyard. So it's really important to stop. Don't miss that. Because what you had, he went out to what we call the labor resource. He saw them. He chose some men. And they contracted for a certain amount for the day's work. They were just savvy enough to say, yeah, well, we'll do this if you do that. So they had a contractual obligation to a certain amount. Verse 3, and going out about the third hour, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And to them he said, you go into the vineyard too, and whatever is right I will give you. So they went, going out again about the sixth hour, and in the ninth hour he did the same. And about the 11th hour he went out and found others standing. And he said to them, why do you stand here idle all day? They said to him, because no one has hired us. He said to them, you go into the vineyard too. And when evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to the foreman, call the laborers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last up to the first. And when those hired about the 11th hour came, each of them received a denarius. Now when those hired first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received a denarius. And on receiving it, they grumbled at the master of the house, saying, these last work only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day in the scorching heat. But he replied to one of them, friend, I'm doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last worker as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or do you begrudge my generosity? So the last will be first, and the first last. So the last will be first, and the first last. So what would you say about this text? Would you side with those who worked all day and got the same amount as the ones who just worked an hour? Would you feel like that? Would you feel like it's a natural feeling? How many of you have been an employer? How many of you have done that to people that you've hired? It's not really normal, is it? But to make the point, Jesus is sharing that God's good graces are just that. First off, you have to realize that the first negotiated a price. They contracted to a certain amount. So what do they have to complain about? They got what they agreed to. And these who, at the end, received the same amount, what was that called? What is that called? That is called grace. That is called wonderful grace. And Jesus is pointing that out here that we should kind of swallow and meditate on. So what I did with my grandkids, 2.5 weeks ago, I got time cards. And I just decided they need to see what the real life is about. They're not necessarily going to be ranchers. They're not going to be out there all day long and all night long working. They might have an 8-to-5 job. So I thought, that'd be good for them to see that they're going to record their work they do. And don't worry, we didn't have slave labor. We went out and had fun, too. but I spent some time with them, letting them record down what they did. And then, just before they left, I sat them down yesterday morning, and I said, okay, it's time to settle up. Papa's going to settle up with the grandkids. How many of you are done with that? How many of you have done that before, where you've been there and you get to bless your grandkids? So Lynn and I discussed a certain It was good, because you don't want to sit there and make it easy. You know, kids getting rich off of Nana and Papa. So I sat them down, and I read this parable to them. And then I started handing out the money. And each one got the same amount. Even the 8-year-old, who really couldn't find a lot that she did. She just had to look cute. She did a great job.
She had a blank time card.
What was that?
Time card.
Yeah, her time card was blank, you know. She's just having a good time. So, and then you just saw the kids just laboring, having a ball doing it. And I enjoyed passing out the greenbacks to my kids, my grandkids. It was a joy that I just took pleasure in. And that's the way God's going to behave towards his children. Now, what's the point there? What is it? Why? What did I have to say to them that would be a life lesson? I stood them all up. And I said, listen, 2.5 weeks ago, when you came on, and I gave you the time card, you didn't do like that first group. You didn't say, well, Papa, I'm only going to work if you give me this much money. Wow, I noticed that. They went to work with joy, and they had a ball. Well, a lot of the times I was right there with them. We were picking up those clinkers out of the rotomill. We were having a joyful time in labor. We were working together doing those things, and you know what I'm talking about because you've been there with your grandpa maybe, or you've been there with your grandkids doing it. What a joy it is. So what did they depend on to know that Papa was going to take care of them? Relationship. Relationship. They were looking to me, and they knew I wasn't going to give them something bad for their labor. They trusted, and they weren't saying, well, Papa's not going to let me sit up at the table, and I'm not going to have any food if I don't work. There was none of that. There was no conscription. They went after those jobs with a joy that was inspiring. Now, I say all that to turn to a text in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 7, verse 7. So just keep in mind God's relationship. See, he's not talking about outside of the family. This whole thing is about family. And Jesus is going to talk about family in Matthew chapter 7. Matthew 7, starting with verse 7. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, it will be opened. Or which of you, if his son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? It's relationship. It's relationship that you have with the Father. When we come together and pray, you're depending on that relationship through Jesus Christ the Son and in the power and presence of the Holy Spirit to ask him for things. He wants us to ask. He wants us to be bowed before him together as a group, bringing our requests to him. He wants us to have burdens, but he does not want us to carry those on our own shoulders. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. Cast your burdens upon him because he cares for you. It's that relationship. Jesus looks at the crowd in a very simple picture who says, who of you has a son who asked for bread that you would give him a stone? That's not relationship. But the relationship with the Father is he gives to you. Does that mean that all your prayers are going to be answered the way you want them to be answered? Those of you who are most mature out there are saying, of course not. I know because I've asked, you say. There are many times I asked, and I was still on an unemployment line. I asked, and the calf still died. I asked, and I still lost my loved one. But it does not diminish God's good graces.
It does not diminish his love for you. He is the Father. So what I'm asking us to do is that we would spend some time together in prayer. There are cities that are on fire today. There are riots that are taking place all over the U.S. And I think it behooves us that we would spend some time together in prayer, lifting these needs up. Why did you come today? I get paid to come here. You came here because you wanted to hear from Christ. You wanted to worship the Lord together. You wanted to have a community where you could worship Christ and hear from the Word. We're told in Romans chapter 15, verse 4, that the scriptures have been given to us to give us encouragement, endurance, and hope. And that's what we're going to do today. We're going to spend some time living underneath that hope that we have in Christ. I'd like to break into clusters of five or six, two or three. There's no rule. But let's pray for about 10 minutes. And if you're uncomfortable with that, you can pray by yourself. But let's lift up the needs that we have in our country, starting with praying for the president and his cabinet, praying for our states, praying for those who are ill from the coronavirus, praying for those who are angry over the unjust killing of a man in Minneapolis, a brother in Christ who died a horrific death unjustly. Let's spend some time praying that people who depend on the rule of law would not destroy the rule of law, expecting that that's going to solve their problems. So I don't know how to say ding the bell and you guys break into groups of praying, but let's do it right now. I'm going to come up here and pray with my wife, and if I can have you two pray with us, I'd really Ron and Cindy, and let's break into some groups and pray, okay? All right, so if you're ready to gather back together, we'll close. Open up your hymnal to 363. We're going to close the song, and I'll pray benediction. More love to thee.
More love to thee, O Christ.
Have a great week.